From our earlier lectures, we have been introduced to two different length scales associated with a superconductor. One is the penetration depth, which is the distance up to which the magnetic field actually enters into the superconductor, and the remaining part of the superconductor has B is equal to 0. From the edges, how much of magnetic field penetrates, up to what distance the magnetic field penetrates into the superconductor is given by the superconducting penetration depth lambda. And the coherence length is the size of the Cooper pairs, the pair of electrons which are paired up. The typical size of each Cooper pair is the coherence length. So, these are two fundamental length scales associated with any superconductor once it gets into the superconducting state at T less than Tc. And one defines an important parameter which is called kappa, which is the Ginzburg-Landau parameter. It is the ratio of lambda to xi. And it was shown that if kappa is greater than 1, or more precisely greater than 1 by root 2, then one has type 2 superconductors, namely that up to a lower critical field, you have the Meissner state. That means for fields less than HC1, the magnetic field is completely shielded from the interior of the sample. Magnetization is minus of H. Here magnetization is minus of H, so the slope is minus 1. And for fields above the critical field, the diamagnetism decreases very slowly. So, in this case, you have superconducting regions and the system breaks up into microscopic normal regions, which are called as vortices. So, the superconductor actually breaks up into superconducting regions which are diamagnetic, and there are normal regions which are, of course, non-diamagnetic. And so, the diamagnetism decreases very gradually as you go up to HC2. This sort of discussion and showing that these vortices actually organize themselves into a very ordered arrangement was done by A. Abrikosov, for which he won a Nobel Prize in 2003. So, these are type 2 superconductors which happen when kappa is greater than 1 by root 2. This was explicitly shown by Abrikosov, and these vortices which are generated above HC1, between HC1 and HC2, these normal regions actually organize themselves into a very ordered arrangement, which is actually a hexagonal lattice of vortices. And so, this type 2 superconductor, you will see a vortex state where the normal regions are not randomly placed, but they are arranged in a very periodic ordered configuration. So, this was the vortex state, and if kappa is less than 1 or kappa is less than 1 by root 2, then you have the conventional type 1 superconductor where magnetization for fields less than Hc, your magnetization is minus 1 of H, and at Hc, superconductivity is lost. It becomes normal. Entire superconductor in one shot becomes normal. There are no vortices generated in the case of type 1 superconductors. Now, before I get further, one very important point of these vortices is that if this is the top view of the superconductor and I have applied a magnetic field to it, this is the magnetic field applied to the superconductor, this is the top surface of the superconductor, and this is the material, then the vortices actually pass from end to end of the superconductor. The vortices are actually passing from end to end of the superconductor. They are like cylinders which are present inside the superconductor. These are normal cores, these are normal regions of the superconductor. And so, if you apply a magnetic field where B is greater than BC1 and it is B should be less than BC2, then you will form in type 2 superconductors these vortices. And what is interesting is that these vortices, the diameter of these vortices is twice the coherence length. Each vortex diameter is twice the coherence length, and each of these vortices being normal regions, non-diamagnetic, the magnetic field is actually present inside these vortices. So, there is magnetic field present inside the vortices, and they also leak a little out into the diamagnetic regions of the superconductor, and the distance up to which they leak out, the magnetic field inside the vortices leak out, is over a distance which is twice the penetration depth. And around each vortex there are shielding currents which are circulating, and these currents also extend up to a distance which is given by the penetration depth. Now for each vortex you can find the integral of B bar dot ds, which is the magnetic flux in each vortex, and one can show that each vortex carries a fixed amount of magnetic flux, which is called as the magnetic flux quantum. Magnetic flux quantum. So, each vortex carries a fixed amount of magnetic flux, which is the integral of the magnetic field enclosed by each vortex over the area of this vortex, and that turns out to be an integral multiple, or it is basically one flux quanta. Each, typically most vortices in most superconductors carry only one flux quanta, and they are in integral multiples of this fundamental quantity h, which is your Planck's constant, divided by twice of E. Why twice of E? This twice of E comes from Cooper pairs, which are the charge carriers in the superconductor, and their total charge is minus twice of E. And a sign that you have Cooper pairs inside superconductor, they are not carrying a charge E, but the charge carriers in the superconducting state have a total charge of twice of E. A proof of that came from measuring the magnetic flux of each vortex. When they measured the magnetic flux of each vortex, it was shown to be H by 2E, and this 2E proved that the Cooper pairs have a total charge of minus 2E, or these are a pair of electrons. And so, it is very important for you to remember that these vortices or these normal regions which are being created in type 2 superconductors between the lower and upper critical field carry a fixed quantum of magnetic flux, and that magnetic flux is in units of fundamental constants H divided by 2E. The value is about 2.07 into 10 raised to minus 7 Gauss centimeter square. And this discovery of the arrangement of vortices in type 2 superconductors, the theoretical discussion and why they should be well ordered and so on, that discussion or that derivation and that discovery, which was theoretical first, that work led to another Nobel Prize in this field. Now, after having discussed the nature of superconductivity and all the behavior of a superconductor in a magnetic field, what is the theory for these superconductors, and there is an opening up of a gap around the Fermi energy, and no single electrons can exist within plus minus delta of the Fermi energy, let us look at another interesting and a final aspect which I will discuss about superconductors, and that is junctions between a superconductor and a normal material. So, the first I will discuss the behavior of a metal superconductor junction. So, I can think of a metal superconductor junction as, let us take a metal, a normal metal, and put it and sandwich it with another superconductor. So, you have a metal and you have another superconductor, and let us apply a voltage, measure the current which is going to flow through this system. Will it be unusual, or will it be ohmic, or what will it be? Will you observe something like voltage by current? Will you observe something as you see in Ohm's law, or will it be nonlinear, or will it be like a semiconductor? What will it be? So, let us understand, if you actually measure the current versus voltage, you will find that the current will be 0 up to a certain value of voltage, and only above this value, which is proportional to delta by E, charge of the electron, you will find that the current through the system will appear. So, up to a certain value of voltage, I is 0. Over this entire regime, I is 0. Whether you apply voltage in the positive direction or my negative direction, up to a certain threshold voltage, the current is going to be 0 through this, and only beyond a certain value, current will appear. And this is as far as a simple metal superconductor junction is concerned. It is certainly not like an ohmic system, where the moment you apply a voltage, you get some current, and V is equal to I into R. It is certainly not like this. it more looks somewhat like a forward bias diode. Of course, it is not like a reverse bias diode, but it has some characteristics of a forward bias diode, where beyond a certain threshold voltage, you start getting current through the system. So, how does one understand it? And there is a reasonable simple way to look at this, is that in a superconductor, this end is the metal and this end is a superconductor, and you have an interface between them. This is the interface. So, on one end you have a metal, you have a superconductor, you have single electrons on this end, you also have single electrons on this end. But in the superconducting state, there is some difference. This is the Fermi level in the metallic state and the superconducting state. But in the superconducting side, in this region, no single electron states are available, because electrons pair up. So, in this window of 2 delta around the Fermi energy, you do not have a possibility of having individual electrons. All the electrons around the Fermi energy start pairing up and they are lost from the system. You cannot have any single individual electron floating around with an energy which is within plus minus EF of the Fermi energy. So, therefore, in this window, these are all occupied states. In the superconductor, these are all vacant single electron states, and these are all occupied single electron states. So, you cannot send, by applying a voltage, you cannot send an electron from this end to this end, because these are all completely occupied. So, the current will be 0. Now, when you start applying a voltage, you start shifting the level on one side. However, here also no electron can flow through. This flow is not allowed, and only when your top of your occupied level in the metal side becomes equal to the vacant state, an electron can flow inside the system. Within this gap region, there is no single electron states available, so no electron can enter into the superconducting side. And that is why current is going to be 0 up to a certain voltage, and only beyond a certain threshold voltage will you get a current in the system. One can also think of it in the reverse way, and you can also work it out that how will you get a current in the reverse direction. It will be exactly symmetric. And so, this is how a metal superconducting junction works, that you will have up to a certain threshold no current through the system as you are increasing the voltage, but only beyond a certain threshold voltage current appears inside the system. And that is because of the presence of a gap in the density of single electron states in the superconductor, which does not exist on the metal side. Okay. And so, that is why it is very non-ohmic. Now, and you can see that once the electrons go into the normal, then you have single electrons, and then at higher voltages you start getting an ohmic like response, because then you have single electrons which are scattering because they are no longer paired. So, they start scattering off, and so you get resistance in this region. This is as far as a metal superconductor junction is concerned. These are very useful. They are used for detecting photons, and these metal superconductor junctions have various applications. One example which I just said is that they are used for detecting photons and so on, single photon detection applications. Let's go on to another very important effect, and this was another Nobel Prize which was won for discovering this phenomena. And what is this phenomena? That is called as the phenomena of Josephson junction. Now, I already showed you what happens when you have a metal and you have a superconductor. Okay. You have a metal on one side, you have a superconductor on another side, you have an interface in between, and we looked at the IV characteristics, that the current is going to be 0 up to a certain voltage value, and only beyond a certain value there will be a current which will start flowing. However, suppose you take a superconductor insulator superconductor junction, and if the width, or let us say the thickness of this junction, this insulating junction, is of the order of the coherence length, which is say 10 to hundreds of nanometers. If this thickness of this insulating layer, which is present or sandwiched between two superconductors, if that thickness is of the order of the superconducting coherence length, then if I do a similar experiment, namely I apply a voltage across the junction, I apply a voltage across these two superconducting junctions, and I vary the voltage and measure the current, and I measure the voltage across the junction, then I get something interesting. In this sort of a junction, if the thickness of the insulating layer is of the order of coherence length, what I will find is that even at zero voltage, I will get a finite amount of current in the system, which is absent in the metal superconductor interface. At zero voltage, there was no current. The current was zero and it remained zero up to a certain threshold voltage. But here what you see is that in this superconductor insulator superconductor junction, even at zero voltage, I have a finite current which can be sent through the system. No dissipation. Voltage is zero. I get a finite non-zero current through the system, which means resistance is equal to zero inside the system. So I can send in dissipationless current from one end to the other. Okay, current can flow through the system with zero voltage across the system, or the resistance is actually zero inside the system. And this current across this insulating junction has a maximum value. It is plus minus IC. This is called as the critical current of the junction. And the discovery of this phenomena and its explanation led to another Nobel Prize. Such type of junctions where the thickness of the interface is of the order of coherence length, and you get this specific type of current voltage characteristics where you can send in a current up to a threshold value without any voltage across this junction. This is known as the Josephson junction phenomena. Very briefly, this is what is the Josephson junction phenomena, where up to a finite value of current can be sent through the junction without any resistance or dissipation across the junction, and beyond this, voltage develops across the junction. Now, what is the reason for this? The reason for this is actually quite interesting. The way to think about these Josephson junction is that you have two superconductors with an insulating barrier. This is the insulator I. You have a superconductor 1 and you have a superconductor 2 on two ends. So this is your SIS junction, superconductor insulator superconductor junction. So thickness of this superconductor is of the order of coherence length. Now what happens is that on this end you have a wave function, and this end also you have a wave function psi, which corresponds to the superconducting state. This has a phase phi 1, this wave function has a phase phi 2. And as I told you for in BCS theory, because of the pairing of electrons one with each other, any superconductor, the electronic state is not described by each electrons having an individual wave function. It's a macroscopic quantum state. So the entire superconductor is described by one single wave function having an amplitude and a phase. So this superconductor S1 has a phase phi 1 and of course amplitude psi 0, and this is a wave function associated with S1, and this is the wave function associated with S2. Now if this is very thin, what can happen is that this wave function leaks a little across this boundary and it can enter into other region, and similarly this wave function leaks a little and it actually enters into the other region. As a result, within this region there is an interference. There is an interference of currents which are actually flowing across the junction from either end. Superconductor or Cooper pairs from this end are actually tunneling there is a tunneling across the junction. Similarly, Cooper pairs from this end are tunneling across the junction, and their wave functions start interfering in this region. And this gives rise to, because Cooper pairs can tunnel across the junction, you can get a finite current through the junction without any dissipation across the junction, because these are pairs which are just moving across the junction and they are tunneling across the junction, and the currents in between the two junctions, they start interfering. The two wave functions interfere if the thickness of the junction is of the order of coherence length. And this leads to this type of interesting current relationships, where I is equal to I naught sine delta. Delta is the phase difference across the junction. Phi 1 and phi 2 are the phases on the two ends of the junction. If this is your superconductor and this is your insulating barrier, phi 1, this is the superconductor S 1, superconductor S 2, this is your insulator. Phi 1 and phi 2 are the phases of the waves on the two ends of the, on either sides of the superconductor, and the difference in the phase is phi 1 minus phi 2. The amount of current that is going to flow through the junction is going to be given by the interference of these two waves, and the interference, as you know from optics, is proportional to the difference in the phases. If the difference in phase is of some order, then you will get constructive interference. If the difference is of some other value, then there is a destructive interference. So, the Josephson junction phenomena is actually related to interference of these Cooper pairs, which are flowing from right and left side, and their wave functions are interfering, leading to a net current which is I naught sine delta. Delta is the phase difference. The current is just given by the interference of the waves. And similarly, the voltage which appears depends on the rate of change of the phase across the junction. So, if you apply a finite voltage of the junction, if you apply a constant voltage across the junction, the delta is going to be proportional to the voltage applied V naught times t from this. If V naught is constant, and then you will get I is equal to I naught sine plus some constant V naught t, and there is other factors, there are other factors which will sit out here, plus some other constant delta 2, and this gives rise to an AC effect. The current across the junction, whereas this is a DC current, if you apply a voltage across the junction, the phase starts evolving in this fashion, and that evolution starts oscillating the current across the junction, and this gives rise to the AC Josephson effect. This is called as the DC Josephson effect. I is equal to I naught sine delta, where delta is the phase difference, and this is called as the AC Josephson part, because if you apply a voltage difference across the junction, then the current tunneling through starts oscillating with, as a function of time. This is almost like sine omega t, and this prefactor gives you something called as a Josephson frequency, and a very important standard for frequencies. The Josephson frequency is used as a standard for defining frequencies, as a calibration standard. So, this Josephson phenomena have different applications. If you take two such Josephson junctions in a loop and bias it, okay, with a current, and place it in a magnetic field, where the magnetic field is actually passing perpendicularly across this loop, then the currents from these two arms interfere and lead to something called as a superconducting quantum interference device. The voltage of the junction actually oscillates periodically depending on the flux that is present, the magnetic flux which is present across the junction, and the oscillation period is of the order of phi naught. It oscillates with a period of phi naught, where phi naught is the flux quantum, 2.07 into 10 raised to minus 7 Gauss centimeter square. So, if you see such oscillations, you know you are detecting fluxes which are so small. This is the level of sensitivity that you can get with superconducting quantum interference device, because you will see voltage oscillations across the junction which depend on the flux changing in the junction by these small amounts. And these type of Josephson junctions are finding a lot of applications being used in quantum computation chips. This is an example of a chip which I show here. This is taken from Wikipedia. These are a quantum computation chips which has about 1 lakh Josephson junctions implemented on the chip. And here there is interferences of current, and then you look at different behaviors of this. And so Josephson junction is also a very important effect. It is basically related to Cooper pairs tunneling across an interface if that interface is thin enough, and they start interfering. And this is the phenomena of Josephson junctions. So superconductivity as a phenomena has multiple possibilities of applications. They are used for MRI magnets, for resistance loss, making the losses, power transmissions with zero losses, for levitated magnetic trains, for circuits. They have multiple different applications. They have a potential for multiple different applications. I have just given you a survey of the phenomena of superconductivity, and there is research which continues in this direction, and people are still trying to understand what is the phenomena of superconductivity, how best to understand it. BCS is only one particular aspect and a way to understand superconductivity. People are trying to go beyond BCS and understand other superconductors. And so the field is very rich, and it is one of the areas at the forefront of solid state physics.